वेलकम बैक इन कंटिन्यूएशन रिसिकैम्सलेट डोज इज 500 मिलीग्राम्स क्यूएडी दैट इज 4 टाइम्स अ डे स्टार्टिंग 5 डेज बिफोर द एंटिसिपेटेड ऑनसेट ऑफ साइकिल बिफोर एंटिसिपेटेड टाइम ऑफ साइकिल यू हैव टू स्टार्ट द इथैम्सलेट प्रीवियसली लाइक वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट ट्रैनेक्सिमिक एसिड एंड मेफेनिमिक एसिड दे हैव टू बी taken on the period she has to take, whereas ethambutolate has to be started 5 days before the onset of the cycle and continued for 10 days. This you please remember. So the effect is only 20% reduction in the menstrual blood loss. There is no conclusive evidence of the effectiveness of ethambutolate in reducing menses. The main side effects are headache and rash.
Michirchena enga gala
tappa tappini
ha
tappini gala
sweet neri anni nikkagu
tappukra.
So coming to diasmin, so diasmin is a plant chemical present in many citrus fruits and it is used for treating various disorders of blood vessels like hemorrhoids, varicose veins, venous stasis, bleeding from eye and gums. This diasmin is used. This diasmin is a vasoprotective agent. So the dose is, it is available as 300 to 600 milligrams tablets. So it can be used 3 to 4 times per day during menstruation. Nowadays this diasmin is being combined with other drugs like tranexamic acid and mefenamic acid. Mechanism of action is it inhibits the capillary fragility, decreases the capillary fragility and restores the function of capillaries. So in summary, tranexamic acid is more effective than other drugs, that is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, ethambutolate and diasmin, but both can be used, that is combinations can be used, and either can be continued long term in benefit is obtained. So whenever you are using tranexamic acid or these ethambutolate or non-steroidal inflammatory drugs, we have if the patient has relief of symptoms, then it should be continued for 3 months like that. Then but it should be stopped if there is no response even after 3 cycles, and neither they are contraceptives or cycle regulating. Then NSAID is the drug of first choice when there is concomitant dysmenorrhea. So when there is associated dysmenorrhea is there, you have to start the non steroidal anti inflammatory drugs. So all the trials excluded women with fibroids, so their role in menorrhagia with fibroids is uncertain. So if cause of AUB is fibroids, the role of non-hormonal drugs is not proved. So these drugs are used in ovulatory AUB and also AUBE, these are effective. So coming to hormonal therapy, progestogens, they are useful in AUBO and AUBE. Then commonly we use this norethisterone. It is better hemostriptic drug and it is because it has androgenic properties. You may get a question, which progesterone has androgenic properties? It is norethisterone acetate. It is available as 5 to 10 milligrams tablets. Doses is 3 times a day for control of bleeding. Then you have to taper the dose, like after stoppage of bleeding she has to take 2 tablets per day for 3 days, then 1 tablet per day for the for 16 to 18 days, so that she will get cycle after the stoppage of the drug. Then metoxyprogesterone acetate, is the side effects are less. It has to be started on the day 5 to day 25. Dose is 10 milligrams per day. These progestogens, they will reverse the endometrial hyperplasia along with reducing menorrhagia. So these are effective in ovulatory dysfunction because of anovulation. Under the effect of estrogen, the the patient will be having endometrial hyperplasia. So when we use these progestogens, this will reverse the endometrial hyperplasia and also reduces the menorrhagia. Then depo medroxy progesterone acetate injections are also available. 150 milligrams once in 3 months can be used. But the main disadvantage with this is because the woman will have breakthrough bleeding with irregular bleeding. She will present with irregular bleeding. So patient will not be satisfied. She came for the treatment of AUB. And we, even with the treatment, she is getting irregular bleeding. She won't. Acceptance will be very less with this Depo-Provera. These systemic progestogens are, what are the progestogens we use for AUB? So these are two drugs, that is norethisterone acetate and medroxyprogesterone acetate. These are effective in ovulatory DUB. And then the side effects are nausea, vomiting, headache, water retention. And if the patient is a case of epilepsy, there will be exacerbation of attacks. The mechanism of action of progestins is very important. These progestogens, they inhibit the endometrial growth by inhibiting the synthesis of estrogen receptors. Then they promote the conversion of estradiol to estrone. So estrone is a weak estrogen. Then it inhibits the LH hormone. So by this, three mechanisms, progestogens inhibit the endometrial growth and organized slough to basalis layer. Then they will stimulate the arachidonic acid formation. So these progestogens can be given as oral tablets. That is, just now we have discussed oral medroxyprogesterone acetate and oral norethisterone tablet. They can be given as injections, that is Depo-Provera injections, like that injections they can take. Then they can use it as a intrauterine systems. So Mirena, levonorgestrel intrauterine systems are available. These will be locally acting. These are kept inside the uterine cavity so that progesterone will be released at 20 micrograms per day will be released, and it will act locally on the endometrium. So the total dose of levonorgestrel present in the system is 52 milligrams. So per day, how much is released? It is 20 micrograms per day is released. So it will have local action on the endometrium and it causes atrophic endometrium. It reduces the blood loss by 75% to 95% within 3 months. This Mirena, as soon as you keep the Mirena, the patient will not have the subsidence of symptoms immediately. It takes minimum 3 to 4 months for the subsidence of symptoms. It is the time taken for the local action to occur. So for first 3 months, she should be given other drugs to control the bleeding. So after 3 months only, the effect of Mirena we'll see. Then first line of treatment for reproductive age group, who wants to retain uterus and who wants contraception. So in the reproductive age group, the woman who wishes to retain the uterus and those who wants contraception, then Mirena is the first line of treatment. It is in one of PG exams, they have given the question as LARC. LARC, LARC. You may get a question, 4 marks or 2 marks question, LARC. Instead of Mirena, they may give LARC. So it is long acting reversible contraception. So it releases the progesterone. It releases the progesterone, levonorgestrel, at a rate of 20 micrograms per day. Efficiency is similar to or even better than as a contraceptive. It is equally effective like sterilization. It is indicated for contraception and treatment of heavy menstrual bleeding and protection of endometrial hyperplasia during estrogen therapy. These are the three indications for Mirena. So you practice to draw the diagram of Mirina also. The reduction in menstrual blood loss is between 70 to 96%. You can see the control of bleeding is around 96%, and the benefit is seen after 3 to 4 months. The effects are, it prevents the endometrial proliferation by causing atrophic changes in the endometrium, and it thickens the cervical mucus and it suppresses ovulation. So here you can see it is two effects. It controls heavy menstrual bleeding by causing atrophic endometrium, and also it acts as a contraceptive device. So it inhibits the sperm movement by thickening the cervical mucus and thinning of the endometrium. The main drawbacks with Mirina is it is high cost. It costs around 3,000 to 5,000. So irregular bleeding for patient will be continued to have irregular bleeding for 1 to 2 months. So some backup drugs for control of bleeding must be given. So 46% underwent hysterectomy after Mirina. So even though they have used Mirina, so 46% may end up with hysterectomy after Mirina. So it is difficult. That is, it requires training or technical training to insert. Then there will be chances of ectopic pregnancy. This Mirina does not inhibit the pregnancy in the tubes. So there is chances of ectopic pregnancy will be there. And amenorrhea is present in 25%, which may not be preferred. So after 6 months after insertion of Mirina, many patients will complain of amenorrhea, which may not be preferred by many women in reproductive age group. And there will be risk of perforation while inserting the device. The contraindications are, when the uterine cavity is distorted, like with multiple fibroids is there, the cavity may be distorted, then it is difficult to insert and it is contraindicated. Then in case of breast and genital malignancies, liver diseases and reproductive tract infections, we should not use Mirina. So you may get a 4 marks question on Mirina. It is a commonly repeated question. Then Emily is intrauterine system is reduced. It is small size, useful for women with small uterus. And the cost is also, it comes around 2,500. Effects is, compared to endometrial resection for management of AUB, this Mirina is comparable to endometrial resection for management of AUB. And it is superior to other antifibrinolytic agents. It may be an alternative to hysterectomy in some patients. So patients with AUB and in reproductive age group, who wants to retain the uterus, you can keep Mirina as the first line of treatment instead of going for hysterectomy. The side effects with Mirina are breakthrough bleeding in the first cycles, and 20% will develop amenorrhea within 1 year, and some people may develop functional ovarian cysts. And special indications are intractable bleeding associated with chronic illness and ovulatory heavy bleeding. This can be used. Then coming to other drugs, hormonal therapies, combined oral contraceptive pills. They contain both estrogen and progesterone, and they act on the hypothalamo-pituitary ovarian axis to suppress the ovulation and causes the endometrial suppression. And if the dose is not sufficient, it may cause breakthrough bleeding. And after the stoppage of the drug, if you don't taper the drug, if you stop it suddenly, the patient will have withdrawal bleeding. It reduces the menstrual blood loss by 40 to 50%, and it is less beneficial because if the patient wants contraception and patient is having AVB, you can use this combined OCPs. But if the patient wants children or she wants to conceive, then we cannot use this combined OC pills. The side effects with OC pills are headache, migraine, weight gain, breast tenderness, nausea, hypertension, and thrombotic episodes. Then coming to androgens, danazol, it is a derivative of 17 alpha ethinyl testosterone. A dose is 100 to 200 milligrams per day. But we are not using this danazol because of androgenic side effects. There will be deepening of the voice and hirsutism will develop. So we are not using this tablet. Then gestinone, it is a synthetic derivative of 19-nor testosterone. Dose is 2.5 milligrams orally, twice daily they can take. Then mechanism of action is, it causes hypoestrogenic, hyperandrogenic and endometrial atrophy occurs. So because of this atrophic endometrium, there will be reduction of blood loss by 50%. The side effects with this are weight gain, oily skin, acne, hirsutism and deepening of the voice, which no woman will accept these side effects. So we are not using the androgens. So coming to GnRH analogs, the available drugs are leuprolide, goserelin, buserelin. Dose is 3.75 milligrams every 28 days for monthly doses for 3 months. It is highly effective. The patient will have amenorrhea, but because of hypoestrogenism, they will present with hot flushes, dryness of the vagina, and osteoporosis. It is reversible osteoporosis. So add back therapy with estrogen must be given to prevent osteoporosis. So that is, estrogen supplementation must be given along with these GnRH analogs. Otherwise, osteoporosis will develop. Short-term therapy before surgery. That is, if the patient is not fit for surgery or she is grossly anemic, so to improve the general condition, 3 or 4 months may be needed. So in those short term, for those in that period, you can use this GnRH analogs for control of symptoms, and after that you can post for surgery. So coming to SERMs, SERMs, that is selective estrogen receptor modulators. It is armeloxifen, otherwise centchromin. It is available as 60 milligram tablets. It has to be taken as 60 milligrams twice weekly for 3 to 6 months. Saheli is the oral contraceptive. Twice weekly, we advise her for contraception. So this, we ask the woman to take the tablet on Monday and Thursday for 3 months. So there will be control of symptoms. After that, weekly once for 6 months she can take. These are SERMs, that is selective estrogen receptor modulators. Other drugs like selective progesterone receptor modulators are also available. So the drugs which are not to be used in AUB is danazol, and these progesterones should not be used only during luteal phase, because these progesterones, whenever you are using, it has to be started from the 5th day to 26th day, not from the 16th to 25th day, you remember. So coming to surgical treatment. Surgical treatment can be conservative surgeries and radical surgery. In the conservative management surgery, endometrial ablation and uterine artery embolization. Radical surgery is hysterectomy. These minimal invasive surgeries are conservative resection techniques. They are used whenever there is AUB refractory to medical management. That is, AUB not relieved with our progesterone, tranexamic, non-hormonal therapy and all. If it is not relieved, then the patient wants to retain the uterus and she doesn't want hysterectomy, you can go for these minimal invasive surgeries. and when the woman is young woman who wants to conserve the uterus and woman is at risk of for surgery. Sometimes the patient may not be risk for surgery, may not be fit for surgery. Then you can opt these endometrial ablation techniques. These endometrial ablation techniques are divided into two types. That is first generation and second generation. The only difference is very easy. First generation endometrial ablation, we do it through the hysteroscope. So when you use hysteroscope and through the hysteroscope, we do endometrial ablation, means it is first generation endometrial ablation. When we do the procedures without using hysteroscope, then it is second generation endometrial ablation. So first generation endometrial ablation can be loop endometrial ablation, roller ball therapy, or laser ablation. So in this loop and roller ball therapy, we use electrical energy to ablate the endometrium. In the laser endometrial ablation, we use the laser wave. In the second generation endometrial ablation, we can use thermochoice, that is balloons filled with fluid, and through that temperature will be increased to ablate the endometrium. Or microwave can be used, or hydrothermal ablation, cryotherapy, electrodes can be used, and laser interstitial hypertherapy, photodynamic therapy. These are the various ablation techniques and classification into first generation and second generation. So indications for this endometrial ablation therapy is failure of medical treatment, family is completed, because once you ablate the endometrium completely, the patient will not have the chance to conceive again. And the cavity size is less than 10 centimeters. That is uterus enlargement less than 10 centimeters. If there is submucous fibroid less than 5 centimeters, and then endometrium is normal or low risk of hyperplasia, you can use endometrial ablation therapies. The complications with these first generation methods is uterine perforation. That is, while introducing this hysteroscope, we may perforate the uterus. Bleeding may be there, infection, fluid overload. Because we are for distending the uterus, we will be using some fluid. So fluid overload can occur, and gas, risk of gas embolism will be there. So contraindications for MIS is large uterus, that is size more than 10 centimeters, and distorted cavity due to fibroids. And then woman who wants to preserve the fertility, you cannot use this endometrial ablation methods. And women who are having suspected gynecological malignancy, women at high risk of endometrial cancer, then perimenopausal women and previous cesarean sections and myomectomies. Because when there is scar is there, there will be thinning of the myometrium, and there is chance of perforation will be more. In the perimenopausal woman, hysterectomy is the treatment surgery of choice instead of conservation of uterus. So examples of this is first generation TICRI. They say TICRI, T is transcervical resection of the endometrium. TCRE is TICRI, they usually commonly call it as transcervical resection of the endometrium using electrical diathermy, that is loop diathermy. Then roller ball electrocoagulation, laser ablation using NDR laser. In the second generation, when microwaves are used, it is microwave endometrial ablation, that is MIA. Then thermal balloon endometrial ablation is cavitrum. RI area is radio frequency induced ablation. Then cryotherapy, electrode mesh, and endometrial laser therapy. These are the examples. The difference between first generation and second generation minimal invasive surgeries is, first generation is performed under hysteroscope and glycine is used as the distending medium, and preparation of endometrium with denazole and GnRH analogs is required. Because before you are going for endometrial resection, you first make the endometrium atrophic, that is make it thin, then only you can use this ablative procedures. It has to be performed under general anesthesia, difficult to perform, learning curve is long, that is training period you require training for long periods and the risk of uterine perforation is there. Whereas second generation methods are simple and quickly you can perform, safe and easy to learn. This is roller ball. This is the roller ball resectoscope. So with electrical energy will be passed through this roller ball and it will be rolled from above downwards to ablate the endometrium. So this is loop. This is the loop through which the electrical energy is passed to ablate the endometrium. So this is the micro wave endometrial ablation. This is the probe from which these microwaves are emitted and they will cause the ablation of the endometrium. So it can be, so here they use the magnetic energy. It can be done as a OPD procedure. It is done under local anesthesia through the applicator of 8 mm size. You can see the size is very small, only 8 mm. Temperature will be increased to 80 degrees for 3 minutes so that endometrium will be ablated. The operating time is only 10 to 15 minutes. Success rate is 80 to 90%. This is MEA, M-E-A. That is microwave endometrial ablation. You must know all these names. You may get write the conservative surgical management of AUB. Then you must write this classification. You mentioned 2 or 3 points about each. Then thermal balloon ablation. So this is the balloon tip. And through this, a fluid will be, this will be introduced into the uterine cavity. You can see the instrument is introduced into the uterine cavity. Then balloon is inflated with the fluid and heated to 87 degrees. Then ablation, the cycle takes 8 minutes. So this is the balloon and fluid is introduced with the syringe and temperature is increased by the temperature will be increased. Then coming to RIA or radio frequency induced ablation. That is radio frequency, electromagnetic thermal energy is used. Then under general anesthesia, procedure time is 20 minutes. No distending medium is used and no hysteroscopy is required. Then coming to another conservative surgery, conservative management of this AUB is uterine artery embolization. So polyvinyl particles are introduced into the uterine artery to reduce the blood supply to the uterus. So there will be so there will be shrinking of the fibroids and also relief of symptoms in AUB. So indications are heavy bleeding, that is AUB, and large fibroids is there, then also you can use uterine artery embolization. The adverse effects of this is the woman will continue to have persistent vaginal discharge, post embolism syndrome. Like they will have pain, nausea, vomiting, fever for 3 to 4 weeks after this procedure. And sometimes they need additional surgery. And premature ovarian failure and hematoma formation are the complications of uterine artery embolization. And coming to hysterectomy, it is the radical treatment modality for surgical treatment for AUB. Indications are when there is failure of medical treatment and the woman has completed her family and does not want to retain the menstrual function, then you can do hysterectomy. It can be done under abdominal route, vaginal route or laparoscopic route. Advantage of this hysterectomy is complete cure and avoidance of long-term medical treatment and removal of any missed pathology. The disadvantages is it is a major operation. It will have its own risk complications and also anesthesia risk. Hospital admission is required. Mortality and morbidity will be more when compared to conservative methods. okay. If you have any, so we come to the end of this topic. We discussed about the management. So in this management, what is our aims of management? You must be able to write. That our aims is first control of bleeding, correction of anemia, then prevention of recurrence of bleeding, identification of the cause and treat the cause. So you must be able to tell all the investigations to come to the diagnosis. Then how will you treat that condition? So for control of bleeding, what are the drugs are used? So that is hormonal therapy, medical therapy and surgical therapy. In the medical therapy, hormonal and non-hormonal drugs, and in the surgery, as we have discussed, conservative and radical. Okay, any doubt, you please read the textbook. Then if you have any doubts, you can express. So tomorrow we will discuss about puberty menorrhagia and postmenopausal bleeding and end this topic. Okay, thank you. So medical ablation means we have to write all medical treatment. No, medical ablation means, what is medical ablation? Microwave, MEA. There is no term, no? Medical ablation.